is the lecture Safe for Democracy, the United States and the World, War I, 1916 to 1920. We have five learning outcomes for this lecture. First, we'll discuss in what ways the progressive presidents promoted the expansion of American power overseas. Second, we'll analyze how the United States got involved in World War I. Third, we'll identify how the United States mobilized resources and public opinion for the war effort. Fourth, we'll discuss how the war affected race relations in the United States. And fifth, we'll analyze why 1919 was such a watershed year for the United States and the world. So in this chapter, we start talking about American liberal internationalism, this kind of progressivism that's moving beyond American shores and being disseminated to the world, whether the world wants it or not. And you need to understand that America is an empire. It had been since the Spanish-American War. But it was a terribly small empire in the 1910s, especially when compared with the great world states of Europe, with France, with England. The United States really was a territorial pipsqueak. But the real power that America had didn't lay in territorial control or military might yet. Instead, it laid with American wealth, American culture, and American intellectual ideas. And it's kind of a myth that the world has only recently globalized. Globalization, in fact, did already exist at the turn of the 20th century. The British pound and banks dominated international trade, and Americans dominated the manufacturing of goods. One-third of all goods were manufactured in the United States. And we also had this kind of open concept of an open door, free flow of trade, free flow of investments, information, and culture emerging as a key feature of U.S. foreign relations. And so with that in mind, you need to see that foreign policy comes to be understood in terms of freedom in the 20th century, right? Our foreign policy is no longer going to be defined in terms of a great nation state working for its own advantage, but instead is increasingly going to be analyzed through the prism, at least rhetorically, of this concept of freedom. And to this end, we have Woodrow Wilson's liberal internationalism. Liberal internationalism was this idea that economic and political progress go hand in hand. And so it followed then that greater world freedom would follow from increased American investment and trade abroad. Now, of course, this often served as a mask for American naked power and self-interest, but the two and two could and sometimes did comfortably coexist, but not always. Sometimes this is just window dressing for naked American aggression. But it's during this era that we see a big shift in American foreign policy, a shift away from being the example for the world to look at, that kind of shining city on a hill, and towards active intervention to remake the world in America's image. And that's huge. It goes from, look at me, I'm doing well, to I'm going to force you to behave the way I think you should. And that happens largely under Woodrow Wilson. Our first learning outcome we're going to discuss is discuss the ways in which progressive presidents promoted the expansion of American power overseas. And we start by talking about Theodore Roosevelt's foreign policy. Roosevelt was going to take a more active role in international diplomacy than most of his predecessors ever had. And he likened his foreign policy to the phrase, "Speak softly, but carry a big stick." In other words, you don't need to go out there and scream and make noise and brag, but you need to have power behind you, right? If I'm carrying a baseball bat and I tell you to back up, I don't need to yell it at you, right? It's very clear that I can enforce my will if I want to. And this is what he likened his foreign policy to. The area that Roosevelt is going to be pursuing a very activist and interventionist policy will be in Central America, particularly with the Panama Canal. So the Panama Canal had a long history. For years and years, people had wanted to build a canal in Panama to link the Pacific and the Atlantic Oceans. This would be a way to facilitate shipping and sharing navy between the two oceans. Because as it stood, if you had a ship, say a warship in the Atlantic Ocean, the only way to get it to the Pacific Ocean was to sail all the way down around the tip of South America and on up, which was time consuming, which was dangerous. It would be much better if we had a shortcut, right? And the best place that most people thought we could do it was through the Isthmus of Panama. Now, Panama was not a country yet. Panama was a territory in the country of Colombia, right? So this is just a part of Colombia called Panama. Well, the United States had been negotiating to build this canal with Colombia, but in 1903, negotiations broke down. Colombia had refused to cede the land for the project. And so in response, Teddy Roosevelt will set in motion an uprising by Panamanian conspirators in the Isthmus of Panama. And this uprising was with the intention of breaking this territory of Colombia away. Roosevelt will send in U.S. Navy ships to prevent the Colombian army from intervening. Once this happens, Panama declares independence from Colombia, which of course Teddy Roosevelt immediately recognizes, and I'm sure coincidentally, then gives the United States a treaty to build the canal, and it gives the United States sovereignty over the Panama Canal Zone, which was about a 10-mile wide strip of land through which the route would run. And so the canal would be completed in 1914, but it would remain a major source of tension between the United States and Panama, as well as Colombia, for ever since, right? Because the United States controlled the Panama Canal, not Panama. And it won't be until 1977 that President Jimmy Carter negotiated a treaty to try to help better relations between the United States and Latin America, and specifically Panama, which led to the Panama Canal to be being turned over to Panama in 2000. Though to be fair, by this point, U.S. ships weren't really using it anymore anyway. They had gotten too big for the Panama Canal, and it would have taken, you know, lots and lots of money to deepen it and widen it and make it appropriate for American warships now. So it was less of an issue. But it would remain an outstanding issue until America finally gives it back about 100 years later, right, in 2000. Roosevelt's also famous for what's called the Roosevelt Corollary to the Monroe Doctrine. And so before we can talk about what the corollary is, we first need to know what the Monroe Doctrine was. This was passed or issued way back under James Monroe. And it said that the United States would view any further attempts at colonization in the Western Hemisphere as a hostile act. In other words, the Western Hemisphere is our backyard. Europe needs to stay out. Now, it wasn't rollback, right? If Europe already had a colony here, then it could stay. But any future interference, the United States kind of reserved the right to intervene and prevent. And of course, the United States didn't have the power to do this until, you know, mid-20th century. The only reason why this really works is because Britain enforces this for us, and they do it for their own kind of cynical purposes. Well, the Roosevelt corollary was the argument that the United States had the right to exercise, quote, an international police power in the Western Hemisphere. So not only do we have the right to keep others out, but if a country in our hemisphere is misbehaving, we have the police power, if you will, to go in and make them behave the way we should. And so this is going to lead to American intervention in Latin American countries all throughout the early part of the 20th century and well into the 21st century. We do it with the Dominican Republic in 1904, for example, when the U.S. seized the customs house to ensure that the Dominican Republic was paying its debts to Europe and paying its debts to American investors. We went in and forcibly took it over, made sure they paid their debts. And we also intervened twice in Cuba in 1906 and 1909. We sent Cubes to Cuba to make sure that our guy, Tomas Estrada, stayed in power after tense elections and after popular uprisings. Now, Taft is going to continue this tradition on. He does intervene, for example, in Nicaragua to protect an American-friendly government. But he intervenes a lot less than Roosevelt did. And instead, he relied on what he called dollar diplomacy. And that is that Taft emphasized economic investments and loans from American banks rather than direct military action in order to try to control these countries. And so that's still an exercise of imperial power, right? But rather than this emphasis on hard power, I go in and take you over, Taft concentrated more on soft power, the power of the purse, of diplomacy, of providing loans and investment and aid. So if we need to pause the video, please do so now. And then, of course, Wilson gets elected. And Wilson comes at this from a different point of view. Wilson himself was the son of a Presbyterian minister, so he kind of grew up and has this missionary zeal and moral righteousness to him that Roosevelt and Taft really didn't. To add to this, his Secretary of State is William Jennings Bryan. He's also a very kind of biblical, moral, missionary, zealous type of guy. And in theory, right, these guys are anti-imperialist, but in practice, not so much. This is going to be a case of them saying kind of one thing and when it comes down to it, doing something else. Because Wilson promised a new foreign policy that would respect Latin America's independence and kind of free it from economic domination by the United States. That being said, though, Wilson was a believer in what comes to be called moral imperialism. And moral imperialism was this belief that the United States had a responsibility to teach others democracy, to teach others the lessons of democracy. And so when Wilson's sitting here saying that we're going to respect Latin America's independence, he didn't actually mean that if they weren't behaving democratically in the way that he envisioned democracy, right? And so ironically, it's going to be under Wilson that his policy will produce more military interventions in Latin America than any president before or since. And you can see there on the map all the different times and places the United States is going to be intervening in Latin America before the 1940s. So we'll see it, for example, in Haiti in 1915. The Haitian government had refused to allow American banks to oversee its financial dealings, so Wilson intervened to force them to do so. We see it again in the Dominican Republic in 1916 when they established a military government and the United States came in and seized control of the customs house and began paying the debts that they owed. And Latin American interventions kind of demonstrate the paradox of modern American history. And that is that the presidents who spoke the most about freedom were also the most likely to intervene into the affairs of other country, right? And it leads you to this question of, you know, is when America practices its foreign policy in the 20th century and the 21st century for that matter, is it really being based on idealism, right? This idea that we're going to fix things and make the world better, or is it really just naked real politik dressed up with idealism, right? Are we really just doing stuff to further our own self-interest, using our power, you know, unabashedly, aggressively, and just kind of coloring it with this rhetoric of freedom? And, you know, that's not an easy question to answer, because some people truly did do these things because they believed they were doing the right thing, and some people are cynically doing it and using this language to justify it. So this is kind of the paradox of American foreign policy, right? Is it idealistic or is it just naked power, real politic? If you need to pause to catch up on something, please do so now. Another big international issue that Wilson has to deal with early on in his term is the Mexican Revolution, which began in 1911. So the Mexican Revolution is kind of a mess. You had a dictator in power. His name was Porfirio Diaz. He was not a nice guy. And there is an uprising led by a man named Francisco Madero, who is going to overthrow Diaz's government. Maduro, however, starts doing some things that the United States didn't particularly like, particularly with regard to land and with regard to controlling oil and mining. And so 2 years later, with the backing of the US State Department, though interestingly, Wilson wasn't informed of this, as well as the backing of prominent American companies that controlled Mexico's oil and mining industries, a military commander named Victoriano Huerta is going to assassinate Madero and take over. So the United States has its fingers all in this, right? And so this leads to civil war breaking out. So when the civil war broke out in Mexico, Wilson ordered American troops to land at Veracruz, and the purpose of this was to prevent the arrival of weapons meant to aid Huerta. And he also wanted to use these troops to, quote, teach Mexicans to, quote, elect good men. And you see the rhetoric at the time that the United States are talking about these troops being greeted as liberators, right? That they would be so grateful to Americans for invading their country. And surprise, surprise, they were not greeted as liberators. They were greeted as invaders. And this is something we keep doing as Americans. We keep using this rhetoric and surprised when countries don't welcome our armed intervention. Anyways, Huerta eventually will resign in 1914. He ends up fleeing the country. And then Mexican factions begin fighting amongst themselves to fill this power vacuum. And we kind of have three big players here. The first is a peasant uprising in southern Mexico, which was led by Emiliano Zapata. They demanded land reform. Unsurprisingly, though, Wilson is going to back Venustiano Carranza, who is somebody who supported modernization and was far more in line with American notions of free market capitalism rather than these peasant ideas of land redistribution. You do also have another leader bouncing around. His name is Francisco Pancho Villa. He also led a peasant force, and he's famous because he, after the United States recognized his rival Carranza as president, Pancho Villa will begin crossing the border into New Mexico and raiding American towns. He ends up killing 17 Americans, which prompts the United States, with Carranza's approval, to send the United States Army under the command of General John J. Pershing into Mexico, chasing Pancho Villa, trying to catch him. And throughout this invasion, even though it was allowed by Carranza, the American army is faced with harassment and guerrilla tactics, and they never actually catch him. In any event, all three of these guys, Zapata, Carranza, Villa, within 3 years, all of these guys are assassinated too. And Mexico, despite their new constitution in 1917, is going to remain very divided and incredibly unstable. If you need to pause this, please do so now. Now we're going to analyze how the United States got involved in World War I. And the first thing you need to know about World War I is that people at the time did not call it that. They called it the Great War. You need to have a World War II before you have a World War I. So anytime you see references to the Great War, it's World War I and it's contemporary. This is a war that broke out in Europe in 1914, and it was triggered by the assassination of the Archduke Ferdinand from Austria-Hungary. He was murdered in Sarajevo by a Serb nationalist, which kind of triggers this whole train of events. Now you need to know that's the trigger, right? That's the spark that lights off the bomb. It's not the actual bomb, right? The causes of this war are a lot bigger. And there were lots of them. There was competition for colonial possessions in Africa and Asia, which is part of the thing that's going on here. There was militarism among these countries, particularly Germany, is pretty militaristic. Nationalism was raging both between countries and within countries. This is going to be an issue. And of course, you had entangling alliances. You can see on the map the different colors, right? The colors constituted, I guess, teams, if you will. But these alliances were kind of upsetting the balances of power. And it leads to kind of this domino effect where when one country would declare war, then their allies would kick in and declare war, and then the other allies would kick in and declare war. And we have this kind of domino effect where everybody ends up in the war. And so, in the end, to simplify things, we basically have two teams in World War I. We have the Allied powers versus the Central powers. And notice this is at the start of the war, because at the end of the war, these teams look different, okay? But at the start of the war, the Allied powers included Britain, Russia, France, and Japan, kind of, right? Japan's more opportunist here, not really helping. And then the Central powers included Germany, Austria-Hungary, and the Ottoman Empire. And this war is going to be world-changing, right? Because a lot of the countries that jump into this war do not emerge from it. By the end of the war, Russia has disappeared. It's now become the Soviet Union. Germany is no longer going to be a monarchy. It becomes a republic. Austria-Hungary collapses, and is no longer an empire, and it breaks up into a million countries. The Ottoman Empire also collapses and no longer exists, and it gets carved up by the victorious Allies into little states. So this changes the map and the power dynamics of Europe forever. So if you need to pause this video, you can do so now. So early on in the war, Germany is going to want to try to take over France. And the place that they're trying to get to is Paris, right? If you capture your enemy's capital, then, and to a lesser extent today, it kind of assures your victory. So the quickest way from Germany to Paris is actually through Belgium, which at the time wasn't involved, but they get it anyway. So Germany is going to overrun Belgium. They're going to overrun parts of northern France. But then the situation bogs down into trench warfare. And we enter into a very, very bloody stalemate where really neither side is moving. And it becomes a battle of attrition where the goal now becomes to kill as many of your enemy as possible. And you may think that's what war is, but that's not necessarily how all wars are fought. This is intentionally trying to inflict as much carnage as possible, which makes it pretty horrible. Now, trench warfare itself was pretty awful. You can see there what a trench looked like. This is where the soldiers would be sitting for months and months and months. You can imagine how it must have been when it rained, with water up to your waist, right? Or when it snowed. These are hard to get in and out of because if you lift your head up too high, the enemy is going to shoot you dead. So, when dead people would die, the bodies would oftentimes be left there for days or weeks, just kind of decomposing. There oftentimes wasn't enough food, so they'd be eating rats and anything else they could find in there. And technology, the new technology from the industrial era, is going to mean huge slaughter, because they're using this kind of 19th century tactic still. They're using, say, charge, right? But they're charging into machine guns, which have now been invented. They're using chemical weapons against each other. The most famous, of course, is mustard gas. It wasn't the only one they used, but it would kill you, right? It was called mustard gas because it was kind of this brownish orange or yellowish color, and it kind of hung in the air there. And it was a blistering agent, so it'd make your eyes bleed, it'd make your lungs bleed, eventually you drowned in your own blood. They're using tanks, they're using air power, right? All this new technology is coming into use now. Now, the area between the two trenches was called No Man's Land, and it was called No Man's Land because no man came back if you went in there. It was filled with landmines, it was filled with barbed wire. Once you started running, the enemy started shooting at you, launching mortars at you, doing all sorts of things. But the tragedy of World War I was the unimagination of the generals, right? Because they kept doing this thing called going over the top again and again and again. And what over the top meant was they would blow their whistle, and you needed to climb out of your trench, go over the top, right? Race across No Man's Land, jump into your enemy's trench, and kill them, right? And this was the strategy. And so they'd blow their whistle, they'd go over the top, they'd run into No Man's Land, and everybody'd die, right? Even if you happen to make it to the enemy's trench, you were probably going to be one of like three people, right? And then they take you prisoner or killed you. And the generals, instead of going, "Wow, that was awful. That this strategy sucks. We better not do it again," they would say, "Well, you know, they'll never suspect it a second time. All right, boys, over the top again," and then everybody would die. Over the top again, everybody would die, right? And they just did this over and over and over again, to the point where around 10 million soldiers are going to die in World War I. And so much so that Europeans especially call this the Lost Generation, because it was as if an entire generation of young people just completely disappeared, right? Most young men died or were injured in this war. And it also led to this kind of widespread cynicism. The war really did deal a severe blow to the optimism and self-confidence of Western civilization. It showed we weren't creatures of reason, we weren't creatures of progress, and really kind of called into question a lot of the good assumptions that we had about ourselves and about our leaders and about politics and morality and everything. So if you need to pause this video, you can do so now. So as the war engulfed Europe, Americans found themselves sharply divided. Remember, a very good proportion of Americans were foreign born, and many of them had come from Europe. And so, how do you feel if your former country is at war, right? Do you support them or not? So, at first, Wilson proclaimed American neutrality, but very quickly, American commerce and shipping were soon swept up into the conflict. Because as this war became a battle of attrition, attrition isn't just kill as many men, it also means run out of supplies, right? Because you can still have 1 million men in your army, but if they don't have any bullets, you lose. If they don't have any food, you lose. And so attrition wasn't just let's kill as many of the enemy as we can, it also meant let's prevent our enemy from getting supplies, let's prevent our enemy from producing. And so neither side wanted America aiding trading with their enemy. And so the British begin to blockade Germany and stop American ships from trading with them. And the Germans begin a policy of unrestricted submarine warfare. In other words, they had a lot of submarines and they would just sink, they would just blow up ships that were approaching the British Isles. And Americans are, you know, really angry about this. Americans begin arguing for something called freedom of the seas, this idea that the oceans belong to everybody. The oceans are really the international, even today, highway of trade. And that if I'm not at war with you, I should be allowed to use the oceans without interference. And so Americans are angry about this and arguing freedom of the seas, but both sides are doing this. That being said, even though Britain's interfering with our shipping and Germany's interfering with our shipping, Americans are far more angry at Germany because the British aren't killing people, right? Typically. The Germans are. They're blowing up ships. And case in point of this was when the Germans sank the British ocean liner, the Lusitania. You can see a picture of it there. Remember, this is a time before air travel. So if you wanted to travel internationally, you did it on a ship like the Titanic, right? And so the Lusitania was a passenger vessel. Previously, the Germans had warned that the area around the British Isles was a war zone. The Lusitania was a passenger vessel and it was sunk off the coast of Ireland in May of 1915 by a German submarine, killing almost 1,200 civilians, including 120, 24 Americans. And this horrified the world. It would be as if, you know, people started shooting down passenger airplanes, right? It was seen as barbaric and horrific. Who kills 1,200 innocent people who were just trying to get to Ireland, right? And so Wilson's note of condemnation regarding this incident was so strong that William Jennings Bryan actually resigned. He was convinced that Wilson was setting the US up for war, and Bryan was totally against it. And the Lusitania outraged the American public and the world, and it did have the effect of strengthening the hand of people who wanted to intervene into this war. So by the end of 1915, Wilson is aware that war may be on the horizon. He doesn't necessarily want to commit to it at this point, but you need to understand that the United States was completely unprepared for a war. Our army was extremely small. Our navy was extremely small. I mean, we were military pygmies. And so beginning by the end of 1915, Wilson embarks on a policy of preparedness. And this was a crash program to expand the army and the navy. So following the outcry of the Lusitania, Germany in May of 1916 decides to suspend submarine warfare. And they're doing this just because the PR was pretty bad for them. Now, of course, being a politician, Wilson takes credit for this, right? He says, Germany did this because I told them to. Well, that's not actually what happened, but hey, never let truth get in the way of a good political story, right? And so Wilson now starts running for re-election. 1916 is a presidential year. And he's going to run on the slogan, he kept us out of the war, right? This is what he's running on. Now, of course, you know, the next year in 1917, we get in the war. So something is going to change here, right? Because Wilson does win re-election on this slogan, he kept us out of the war. And this election is really, really close. The thing that kind of puts Wilson over the edge is that he ends up winning 10 out of the 12 states that had female suffrage. And so it was very clear that Wilson does not win election without women, right? And so that helps to partly explain why he backs the 19th Amendment in 1919, right? Because he owed his electoral success in large part to women. But he's running on the slogan, he kept us out of the war. Americans clearly don't want war then if he gets elected with this slogan in 1916. And then in 1917, we do. So something changed. And what is it? Well, in 1917, Germany once again resumed submarine warfare and once again began sinking American ships. Mostly because at this point they're getting pretty desperate, right? In addition to that, which made Americans angry again, the Zimmerman telegram was turned over to the United States by Britain. So the Zimmerman telegram had actually been intercepted earlier, and Britain, who really wanted the United States to intervene because it knew that the United States would intervene on behalf of Britain and that would help them, they kept this in their back pocket, right? They kept it for just the right moment when they could slap it down and be like, oh. It's like when somebody, you're dating somebody and they do something messed up, but you don't say anything right away. You're like, I'm going to save it. I'm going to save it for when I need it, right? And this is when they needed it, right? Because Germany starts blowing up our ships and they're like, and by the way, bam. So the Zimmerman telegram was written by Arthur Zimmerman. Arthur Zimmerman was the British foreign, or I'm sorry, the German foreign minister. It's kind of the equivalent of the American Secretary of State. He's also Jewish, by the way, so clearly it was not a problem to be a Jew in Germany until it was. But anyways, the one thing Germany did not want was the United States to get involved in this war, right? Because they knew we would side with Britain. And so they're trying to figure out, how do we keep America out of the war? How do we keep them not intervening? Well, what if we make them busy at home, right? What if we make it so that they're busy on their own continent? Then they won't have time to come over here and mess with ours. And so Arthur Zimmerman wrote this telegram, and it was sent to Mexico City. And in it, he essentially says, Dear Mexico, aren't you angry that the United States stole Texas and California from you in the Mexican-American War? Don't you want revenge? Mexico, if you declare war on the United States to get this territory back, we will help you just as soon as this little kerfuffle in Europe is done, right? And so, of course, Mexico wanted no part of this. Remember, Mexico had just got done fighting a really nasty civil war. They're not in the mood to go fight another one with the United States over Texas and California, which, you know, they had kind of gotten over by this point. But that wasn't the point, right? The point was that here, Germany's blowing up our ships, And now they're trying to induce our neighbor Mexico to attack us. And that really was kind of the last straw. And so on April 7th, 1917, Wilson will go before Congress and ask for a declaration of war, declaring that the world must be, quote, made safe for democracy, unquote. And so note how they're selling this, right? This now suddenly is a war for freedom, a war for democracy, when that's not necessarily the stuff that is prompting this, right? We're mad that they're blowing up ships that we're trying to trade with Europe. Well, we could just not trade with Europe. It's not like they would blow up our ships forever. It was just while the war was going on. We just could have not traded, and that would have solved the problem. He's angry about the Zimmerman note, which went nowhere. Mexico wasn't going to attack us, right? So really, Wilson wants to get involved because he wants to dictate terms of the peace. He wants that moral imperialism, right? But these things aren't very sexy. You're not going to sell this to the American public. So instead, he's going to be grabbing this language, right? Safe for democracy, a war for freedom, to get the American public on board. So if you need to pause this video, please do so now. So the United States is going to get involved in World War I at a really, really crucial point. It's not because we come in at a really important moment. Because at the time, Russia had just recently pulled out of the war. In Russia, there was the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917, which was led by Vladimir Lenin. Eventually, they kill the Tsar, right? And Russia becomes just one of several countries that gets swallowed up by this empire called the Soviet Union, right? The official name of the Soviet Union is the United Soviet Socialist Republic, but the USSR, but that's too long to say, so we just shorten it to the Soviet Union. And keep in mind, it's an empire, so it's swallowed up a bunch of different countries, like Ukraine, like Belarus, for example. So technically, you should call people from the Soviet Union Soviets, right? Because it encompasses all these different kind of nationalities. But we're lazy, so we call them Russians a lot, because Russia was the biggest and most important group there. But keep in mind, it's an empire, right? So there's others there. So Russians, Soviets, we use it interchangeably, even though that's not exactly correct. Anyways, once Lenin takes over, he published the secret treaties that the Allies had made with each other, in which they had agreed to divide up the conquered territory after the war and all kind of the sausage-making machinations that were going on behind the scenes. And it looked like this was not a war to make the world safe for democracy, right? This looked like naked power politics as usual. And so to try to reassure the country that the United States was fighting this war for a good reason, Wilson issues what's called the 14 points in January of 1918. And part of it was to assure the country, right? This is also partly a statement of American war aims, right? Why is the United States fighting this war? And it could point to the 14 points as its point in fighting the war. And it provided a vision of a new international order, very much based on this kind of moralism that Wilson talked about. And it is what it says it is, right? It's 14 different points, 14 different things. And it included things like first, self-determination. Self-determination meant that if you were an ethnic or nationality minority within a country, that you ought to be able to determine for yourself what your government would be, this kind of consent of the governed. And this was particularly important for places like Austria-Hungary, right, which had gobbled up its neighbors. For example, it had gobbled up earlier in history parts of Poland. And so it would say to the Polish people, well, you should be able to decide, do you want to have an independent country called Poland, or do you want to remain part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire? So self-determination was one. A second one, probably the most important one for America, was freedom of the seas, right? Don't be attacking shipping. Everyone should be allowed to use the oceans. A third was free trade, the idea that you shouldn't erect trade barriers, that everyone should be allowed to trade freely, also within America's self-interest. The fourth was the idea of A fourth one was this idea of open diplomacy, an end to secret alliances, an end to secret treaties. All this stuff should be done in public. Because one of the things that leads to World War One is, you know, there were all these secret treaties between each other that get triggered once war breaks out. So this idea of open diplomacy, no more secret treaties. There was also an idea of a readjustment of colonial claims, with colonized people given, quote, equal weight in deciding their futures. This, of course, is completely radical, right? Allowing colonized people to say, yes, we'd like to stay part of the empire, or no, we'd like you to get out, right? That's pretty radical for the time in this age of imperialism. And finally, the most important thing to Wilson was a general association of nations that was designed to preserve the peace. And of course, this general association of nations eventually becomes the League of Nations. And this was the most important thing to Wilson because he was an idealist. And he truly, truly did believe that if only there was a place where countries could have gone and worked out their differences, that war would have been avoided, right? And so the League of Nations was so important to Wilson because he really did believe that this was the key to ending warfare, right? This was the key for world peace. In any event, the 14 points do eventually establish the agenda for the peace conference that followed the war. Now, when Americans finally enter the battle in Europe, they do turn the tide of the war. Not necessarily because they were all that awesome militarily, but just that they were fresh faces, right? To this point, the Europeans had been beating the hell out of each other for a number of years. They were all at their breaking point, and here comes America fresh and invigorated, right? It's as if somebody had been running a marathon and, you know, you show up on mile 26, right? You're ready to go. So the Americans were under the command of General John J. Pershing, he who chased Pancho Villa through Mexico. And they were called, the American Army was called the American Expeditionary Force, the AEF. Their nickname, by the way, was Doughboys, because they were a little bit doughy. They needed to bake a little bit longer. They won't see battle until the spring of 1918. The major battle that Americans fought in was in the Meuse-Argonne region. This lasted a whole month and a half, and it had 1.2 million American soldiers involved and led to around 100,000 being killed. And as awesome as those numbers sound, that's only 1% of the losses of World War One, just to put this in perspective. So America's real power wasn't really in military fighting. America's real power was in industrial output, because everybody else's economies had been stretched to the brink, and America already produced 1/3 of world manufactured goods, and we turned that to war production, and we are just able to outproduce our enemies like nobody's business. But once America comes in after the Meuse-Argonne campaign, the German forces were forced to retreat. At that point, the Kaiser of Germany kind of panics. He flees the country and he abdicates on November 9th, 1918. And there will be an armistice signed 2 days later. And you can remember this, that World War One ends on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, 1918, when the Germans surrender. So if you need to pause to catch up on something, please do so now. We're now going to identify how the United States mobilized resources and public opinion for the war effort. So World War One was the Progressives' War, right? This was, the Progressives were in charge. They're the ones that pulled America into this war, and so they have to own it. And for the Progressives, the war offered the possibility of reforming American society along scientific lines, instilling a sense of national unity and self-sacrifice, and expanding social justice. Some progressives also viewed the war as an opportunity to disseminate progressive values around the globe. And almost all progressive intellectuals, everyone from John Dewey to Samuel Gompers, supported the war. The big exception was Eugene V. Debs, the socialists, and the Wobblies, right? The International Workers of the World. But aside from them, most progressives were on board with this. And so the wartime state is going to increase the power and the reach of the federal government to unprecedented levels. It creates a national state, one that did not exist before and would have been unimaginable to the founders. And it sharply increased the presence of the government in Americans' everyday lives. One example of this is the Selective Service Act, which was passed in May of 1917. This was the draft. It required men to register for the draft, and ultimately 24 million men registered. We also created the War Industries Board. The War Industries Board was headed by financier Bernard Baruch, and it presided over all elements of war production, everything from distribution of raw materials to setting prices of manufactured goods. So if you were a baker in World War I, the War Industries Board would tell you how much flour each month you could have, and it would tell you how much you could charge for your bread. Period. Right? It also standardized production. It's one of the reasons why a size 6 shoe in Texas is a size 6 shoe in New York, right? Because if you wanted to produce for the army, and everybody wanted to produce for the army because the army was buying, they set standards, like a size 6 shoe is this long by this wide by this deep. And so standardization became a thing, whereas before it really wasn't. They also created the Railroad Administration, which controlled America's transportation system. So even though it was in private hands, the government told them what to ship, when to ship it, how far to ship it, how much they were going to pay. The fuel agency rationed coal and oil. It told you how much oil you got, how much gasoline you got a month, how much oil you could have, how much coal you could have. So the free market is gone, right? You also had the Food Administration, which was headed by future President Herbert Hoover. The Food Administration provided instruction and promoted conservation of food on a voluntary basis. And it was very, very effective. You can see this propaganda poster. Sow the seeds of victory, plant and raise your own vegetables, every garden a munitions plant, right? And it was this idea of trying to convince Americans to conserve food so we would have food not just to send over to Europe with our army, but also to feed our allies. And so they would do things like have a meatless Monday, right? Nobody eat meat on Monday. And it sounds like a small thing, but if there were, 100 million Americans and 100 million people didn't eat meat for one day, imagine how much meat that saved, right? And this was really successful. And it helps to explain why, when we get to the Great Depression, Hoover's first response to the Great Depression is one of volunteerism, of having people voluntarily sacrifice to try to get us out of this. Because that's what happened here in the Food Administration, and it worked. Unfortunately for Hoover, the Great Depression is a different animal and it doesn't work there. But this is where he's coming from, right? It's not like he was crazy and super idealistic. He had had this experience and it had worked in the past. We also created the War Labor Board during the war. The War Labor Board included representatives of government, industry, and the American Federation of Labor. And it pressed for a national minimum wage, an 8-hour day, and the right to form unions. So as a result of this, because remember, unions are really good for workers, wages rose during the war, working conditions improved during the war, and unsurprisingly, union membership soared. And all this meant that inequality was lessening during World War I. By 1918, the wealthiest Americans were paying up to 60% in income tax, all to help fund the war. After World War II, they'll be paying over 70%, and in the 50s, they'll be paying up to 90%. And it's interesting because in 2019, at the Davos conference, where the ultra-rich kind of gather to talk about stuff, they were responding to a newly elected Democrat named Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who was elected from New York. And one of the things she was calling for was a 70% marginal tax rate on the ultra-rich, right? And at Davos, the billionaire Michael Dell, who is the CEO of the Dell Corporation, demanded on this panel, name a country where that's ever worked, that 70% tax. And it just so happened that on the panel there was a historian from MIT named Eric Brynjolfsson, and he calmly looked at him and responded, the United States, right? So whether you think that's a good idea or not, the important thing is to know your history before you get slapped upside the head with it and made to look stupid. In any event, inequality for the average personing was lessening. So the rich are being taxed at 60% to help pay for this, and also ordinary Americans are helping to pay for this through the sale of Liberty Bonds. So this was something that was paid for and on every level, from ordinary people buying Liberty Bonds to the very, very rich. So if you need to pause this video, you may do so now. That being said, the Wilson administration decided that patriotism was just too important to leave up to the private sector, that we really needed all Americans on board with this war, and we're going to manufacture patriotism, create it, gin it up to ensure that Americans go along with what the state wants. So understand this, right? This is manufactured. This is created. It was not something that just kind of inherently happened, okay? And it's very different from the Civil War. We don't see this happening in the Civil War. That was kind of left alone. But Wilson decided to use the power of the state to kind of ensure Americans thought the right way about the war. And so America will establish the Committee on Public Information, the CPI, under the control of journalist George Creel. Now, the purpose of the CPI was technically to, quote, explain to Americans and the world the causes of the war. In reality, this was America's propaganda agency. And it aimed its propaganda sometimes abroad, but mostly at home. And propaganda is manipulation, right? It is designed to manipulate you into feeling, thinking, believing, doing whatever. That's what it is. And it's a myth that propaganda is based on lies. Sometimes it is, but the best propaganda is based on truth, right? And it's used to manipulate you, to make you feel, think, believe certain things. And so they would use a bunch of different things. There were pamphlets, there were posters, like you see there on the screen, the recruiting poster. They had things like called four-minute men. Four-minute men were volunteers who would memorize like a four-minute long speech, and they were spread out throughout the country. And if at any opportunity they had, they were supposed to stand up and give a four-minute speech in favor of the war. So you'd be like standing in line at the post office and be like, oh, God, this line is so long, right? I bet it's because of the war. And the guy behind you would be like, the war, you say? Why, can I have your attention, everybody? Let me tell you about why we are in this war and it's good, right? And on it would go. So the CPI's activities really set a precedent for active governmental efforts to shape public opinion in later international conflicts. And we'll see this again in World War II and onward. And the CPI couched its appeal in the progressive language of social cooperation and expanded democracy, right? They're grabbing that language of social cooperation, of democracy, of freedom. At home, abroad, it meant self-determination, right? That's what freedom meant abroad, this idea of self-determination, consent of the governed. And at home, it meant improving industrial democracy, where there would be a universal 8-hour day, there would be a living wage for all. And so in this context, freedom took on new significance because it contrasted America with its, you know, good working relations and living wage and consumer culture with the evil, quote, Huns. And it was so successful and so pervasive, it's found its way even into popular culture. And so I'm going to play for you kind of the song, the anthem, unofficial anthem of World War I, the one that's associated with World War I. It's called Over There. And it takes a second to get started, so I'll start playing it now. But listen to the kind of themes in here, this idea of national unity, this idea of everybody is supporting the war, this idea that the Germans are evil and we're the good guys, and see how it has found its way even into popular culture. ¶¶
tell me, get your gun. Take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, no delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to pine, to be proud her boys in line. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums are coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. Johnny, get your gun. Johnny, show the hun, you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee doodle, do or die. Pack your little kit, show your grip, do your bit. Yankees to the ranks, from the towns and the tanks. Make your mother proud of you, and the old red, white, and blue. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums run coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Okay, so if you need to pause this video, you can do so now. So Americans are wrapping the war around this language of freedom and democracy. And so if you claim that you're fighting for freedom and you're fighting for democracy, you shouldn't be surprised when your own citizens call your bluff, right? Because America's entry into the war is going to lead to groups demanding the rights that we say that we're fighting for. And you see this, for example, in the suffragist movements. Now, the suffrage movement, again, not a new movement, has been around since the 19th century. But entry into the war does strain this. It threatens to tear this movement apart, as there were many suffragists who were opposed to American involvement in the war. Most notably, Jeanette Rankin. Jeanette Rankin was the first female member of Congress, and she opposed the war. She was a pacifist, and she voted no. So that says a lot, right? If she's very much a leader in the American women's suffrage movement and she votes no, what do you do if you're against that, right? She does, by the way, lose election after this, but she gets reelected in 1940 and she votes no again for World War II, right? So she's the only one that did twice, interestingly. That being said, most women suffrage leaders enlisted in the war effort alongside other women. They did things like sold war bonds, they organized rallies, they worked in war production, and they worked as nurses and clerks for the first forces in Europe. But they're also going to be using the war as a vehicle to demand the right to vote. And probably the most important organization for women doing this was the National Women's Party, the NWP, which was led by Alice Paul. And the NWP was militantly fighting for suffrage. And in many ways, it was emulating the British suffragist movement, which had used radical tactics, things like, you know, getting themselves arrested, having themselves imprisoned, calling out patriarchy when they saw it, which is pretty radical for this time. It's even, you know, problematic today if you ever look on Twitter, right? And you call out patriarchy. I mean, the hate that will be generated towards women who do that is pretty unbelievable. So if it's bad in 2019, it's really, really, really bad in 1918, right? So the NWP would do stunts like chaining themselves to the White House fence and get arrested. And after they get arrested, going on a hunger strike. Many of them were, Alice Paul herself was imprisoned in an insane asylum because, of course, she had to be crazy for wanting the right to vote. When she went on a hunger strike there, they beat her up and then they tied her to a chair and force fed her. So lots of women died for this right and suffered greatly. So if you're a female and you're not voting, you should punch yourself in the face because many others have had to suffer through that to get that for you. Anyway, the combined efforts of women's service during the war, as well as the agitation from people like the National Women's Party, do ultimately win women suffrage with the passage of the 19th Amendment. If you need to pause this video, you can do so now. Numerous impulses also flowed into the renewed campaign to ban intoxicating liquor, also known as prohibition. This too, not a new issue, has been around since at least the 1830s. But you have this coalition coming together in World War I of urban reformers, of women, of Protestants, and quote-unquote patriots. And like the suffrage movement, the prohibitionists came to see national legislation as their best strategy. And the war gave them added ammunition because many breweries in the United States were owned by German Americans. And so beer itself came to be seen as unpatriotic, as almost kind of aiding the enemy. And so they do manage to get the 18th Amendment passed, which banned, which prohibited the transportation, sale, and of intoxicating liquors. Coincidentally, it left off consumption. So I guess if you tripped on a bottle of wine, you just got to drink it, right? Anyways, an amendment is just an amendment, right? You actually have to have a law to enforce the amendment. And so the Volstead Act of 1919 is the law that provided severe penalties for violating the 18th Amendment. And very quickly, the 18th Amendment becomes unpopular, as you can imagine. It was very, very unpopular among immigrants, particularly among the German, Irish, and Italian immigrants for whom drinking was a very important part of their culture. And as a result, you had some immigrants forming ethnic gangs in order to import in illegally their own liquor in order to bootleg. And this, of course, is what becomes the mafia, right? Organized crime. It started with prohibition, with them bringing in alcohol, which had been declared illegal. You also have speakeasies forming around the country, these kind of private clubs that were secret, where they're still kind of showing, you know, serving alcohol and stuff like that. That being said, this does forever change American drinking habits, right? Americans will drink less after the 18th Amendment even today than it did before. And it was the most effective in small towns in the South and in the Midwest. But of course, enforcing this required a high degree of public cooperation, which wasn't always there. Even the middle class, who was the one that was pushing the hardest for prohibition, came to discover that they didn't like it. Mostly because it was one of those not in my backyard things, right? The middle class didn't want them drinking. It came kind of different when they discovered they themselves couldn't drink too. So the 18th Amendment is short-lived. It's repealed in 1933 with the 21st Amendment. You can pause this video now if you need to catch up on anything. So this leads us to liberty in wartime, this idea of suppressing dissent and coercive patriotism. Because World War I raised the question, what is the balance between security and freedom? And it's something that we still struggle with even today. Should dissent be equated with a lack of patriotism? Or is dissent the definition of patriotism, right? Eugene V. Debs, who was imprisoned for protesting the war, for example, in his sentencing stated, quote, "I believe the right of free speech in war as well as peace," unquote. Regardless of where you're coming down on this war will lead to the most intense repression of civil liberties the United States has ever known. And we're going to see Congress passing a series of acts seriously suppressing dissent and curtailing freedoms. The first is the Espionage Act in 1917, which prohibited not only spying, but also interfering with the draft and making, quote, false statements that might impede military success. And the Espionage Act is still on the books. We're still seeing Americans prosecuted under the Espionage Act. And the problem with this is that, you know, prohibits words or actions that would aid the enemy or obstruct recruiting, is that there's such a loose interpretation possible. If you say, I think the Kaiser's right, are you aiding the enemy? Maybe, right? Because it's not just actions. It's not just you have to do something. It includes your words. So where's this line? We also have the Sedition Act passed in 1918, which made it a crime to make spoken or written statements criticizing the government or interfering with the war effort. So penalties for speaking or writing against the draft, against bond sales, against war production, for criticizing government personnel or policies. And that's a huge problem. What do you mean I can't criticize the government? In a democracy, that's not only my right, but it's also my responsibility, right? If the government is doing something I believe is wrong or is behaving in a way I don't like, it's my responsibility as a citizen to say something. But this made it a crime. And over 2,000 people will be charged with violating these laws. Eugene V. Debs, for example, was convicted in 1918 under the Espionage Act for delivering an anti-war speech. He didn't even do anything. He just made a speech. And this was especially used to go after socialists, to stamp out the American Socialist Party. Incidentally, Debs ran for president while he was still in prison in 1920 and got over 1 million votes. So there's his campaign button for president, convict number 9653. So I kind of like him just for that. Anyways, this all sounds like it's violating some right I have. I don't know, free speech or something. I think I read that somewhere. So, of course, it gets challenged. And the court case that challenges this is called Schneck v. United States in 1919, and it goes all the way up to the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court upholds these acts. And in Schneck, the United States says that in a situation where there is a clear and present danger, Congress has special powers. In a situation where there is a clear and present danger, such as wartime, Congress has special powers. And furthermore, your freedom of speech is not absolute. For example, you cannot yell fire in a crowded theater. Your freedom of speech is not absolute. For example, you cannot yell fire in a crowded theater. And so this very much placed limits on freedom and allowed the government, in a time of war, unprecedented powers. So what we now enter into is what Foner talks about is this idea of coercive patriotism. This kind of extreme repression took place at the hands of state governments and in private groups. And this idea of who is and is not patriotic is not something new, right? This is a long contested idea. I kind of agree with Emma Goldman, who said it meant to, quote, love America with open eyes. But in World War I, patriotism now meant support for the government, the war, and the American economic system, full stop. Right? You are not allowed to question any of that. You are not allowed to question the government. You are not allowed to question the war. And you were not allowed to question the American economic system the way it was, right? With this idea of freedom of contract, etc. And so in World War I, you have schools forced to revise their curriculum, for example, to ensure that it was teaching this form of patriotism. And that persists even to this day. If you look at the requirements of the Texas Coordinating Board for Education, right? They're kind of demanding that you teach patriotism and frowning upon any kind of questioning the legitimacy of any other form, right? For example, why don't we talk about whether or not socialism is a better system than capitalism? And I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying that, especially in the K through 12, that discussion is not allowed to be had, right? You're also going to see teachers and professors being required to sign loyalty oaths, that they're loyal to the government, that they're loyal to the war, that they're loyal to the American economic system, and be fired if they don't sign them. Well, that seems like that's, you know, infringing on my freedom of thought, right? My freedom of conscience. You have the American Protective Reform. This was an organization that helped the Justice Department identify radicals and critics of the war. Essentially, these were people who spied on their neighbors. They would carry out what were called slacker raids, where men would be stopped randomly on the streets and be forced to produce their draft card. And if they didn't have one, you know, they might be beaten up or turned over to authorities. And the full weight of these laws are going to be turned especially against the International Workers of the World, the IWW, the Wobblies. So just like they went after the socialists, they're going to go after the Wobblies as well. And the federal government is going to swoop down with these very, very broad warrants, raiding their offices, arresting their leaders, all with the intent of destroying this union, which they do, right? And in face of all this, the progressives were largely silent in the face of these civil liberties violations. So again, remember what the progressives do and what they don't, right? They're very concerned about the abuses of capitalism. They're not very concerned about civil liberties. So if we need to stop this video to catch up on something, please do so now. So now we're going to talk about how the war affected race relations in the United States. And you see your book talking about the, quote, race problem. And the race problem, as they called it, had become a major subject of public concern. What they mean by the race problem was the tensions that arose from the country's increasing ethnic diversity. And so during this time period, race is more than just black and white, right? That's not exactly what this means. During this time period, they identified 45 immigrant, quote, races, right? And this is all being helped along by eugenics. Eugenics studied the alleged mental characteristics of different races. And, you know, it made a hierarchy of them. It put some races above others. Of course, you'll be shocked to know that white Anglo-Saxon Protestants were at the top and, you know, black people were at the bottom. But other types of white people were in there too, right? Italians were not as good as Germans, for example, et cetera, et cetera. And it gave this anti-immigrant sentiment an air of professional expertise, this kind of pseudoscience. So no, this is white people categorizing other white people, which tells you then that race is not real. What you need to understand in this class and going forward for the rest of your life is that race doesn't actually exist. Race is a social construct. And there's a nifty video here by Vox that kind of explains what we mean by this that I'm going to play for you.
You may think you know exactly what race you are, but how would you prove it if someone disagreed with you? The fact is, even though race drives a lot of social and political outcomes, race isn't real. One of the first people to attempt to categorize humans according to race was a German scientist around 1776. He came up with five different groups according to physical appearance and geographic origin of their ancestors. Americans of European descent eagerly bought into this type of thinking around the same time. Some historians have said the idea that there were different races helped them resolve the contradiction between a natural right to freedom and the fact of slavery. If whites were their own distinct category, then they could feel a lot better about denying freedom to people who they labeled black and decided were fundamentally different. But as political priorities change, definitions of race in America adjust right along with them. For example, if you were of Mexican birth or ancestry in the United States in 1929, you were considered white. Then the 1930 census changed that to non-white to limit immigration. Later, when the U.S. needed to increase its labor force during World War II, these people were switched back to white. And what it took to be black once varied so wildly throughout the country, from 1/4 to 1/16 to the infamous one drop of African ancestry, that people could actually change races just by crossing state lines. Then suddenly in 2000, the government decided that Americans could be more than one race and added a multiracial category to the census. This has left many Americans scratching their heads when it comes to selecting who they are. As many as 6.2% of census respondents selected some other race in a 2010 survey. The idea that someone might look one way and identify another way, or that they might be really hard to place in a racial category, is not new. This is why there was a public debate about whether MSNBC's Karen Finney could say she was black, or how we can't even agree on the racial label assigned to the President of the United States. Of course, many people feel their racial identity is very clear and very permanent, but the fact that some people have changed theirs and that no one can really argue with them shows how shaky the very idea of race is. This is all because there isn't a race chromosome in our DNA that people can point to. It simply doesn't exist. When the medical community links race to health outcomes, it's really just using race as a substitute for other factors, such as where your ancestors came from, or the experiences of people who may have been put in the same racial group as you. Dorothy Roberts explains that sickle cell anemia is a prime example of this. The disease is linked to areas with high rates of malaria, which include some parts of Europe and Asia in addition to Africa. It's not actually about race at all. This, of course, does not mean that the concept of race isn't hugely important in our lives. The racial categories to which we're assigned can determine real life experiences, they can drive political outcomes, and they can even make the difference between life and death. But understanding that racial categories are made up can give us an important perspective on where racism came from in the first place.
Okay. So, keep in mind that race is made up, and they're making it up as they go along here during this time period. And it's not just white, black, Hispanic, right? It's what kind of, you know, there's 45 different races. So keep that in mind. Now, nationalization of American politics and economic life is going to heighten the awareness of ethnic and racial differences, and it's going to spur the demand for many in this period for Americanization. Americanization was calls for the creation of a more homogeneous national culture. And the playwright Israel Zangwill's Melting Pot in 1908 gave a name to this process by which newcomers were supposed to merge their identities into the existing national American nationality. And this became the standard practice at the time for schools, for labor unions, for employers, all to Americanize immigrants, to expect them to blend into a mainstream white middle class culture. Now, to be fair, a minority of progressives questioned these Americanization efforts and insisted on a respect for immigrant subcultures. For example, Randolph Byrne, in his 1910 essay, Transnational America, pointed out that the biggest flaw to this Americanization plan was that there was no distinctive American culture, right? Americans who live in New York have a different culture than, say, Americans who live in Topeka, Kansas. That being said, this still does become the dominant paradigm during this time period, and to a lesser extent even today, that immigrants who come to this country are expected to Americanize and assimilate into the culture. The biggest group that this Americanization is going to be used against during World War I, of course, are going to be Germans. German Americans will bore the full brunt of this forced Americanization. And it mattered because Germans at the time were the largest ethnic group in America before World War I. They had thriving ethnic institutions, everything from, you know, cultural clubs to German language newspapers to German language schools. And now the use of German and expressions of German culture became the target of pro-war organizations and even in some cases the state. And essentially, they get persecuted out of existence. For example, by 1919, many states had enacted laws restricting even the teachings of foreign languages in schools. And so it had the net effect of destroying German-American culture. Till today, it's, unless it's a tourist trap, virtually gone, when it was as much as one-fourth of the country at a time. This also is going to be used towards immigration restrictions. We have a lot of nativism during this time period, and the war is going to strengthen the conviction that certain kinds of, quote, undesirable persons, unquote, needed to be excluded entirely from the United States. Now, in a certain sense, this isn't new. They had already done this to the Chinese back in the 1880s, but now they're extending it to Europeans. One way they did this was through the use of the IQ test, the intelligent quotient test, introduced in 1916 by Stanford University psychologist Louis Termain. And the IQ is supposed to measure an individual's mental capacity. And they did these tests in the army that seemed to indicate, for example, that blacks and that immigrants were below white Protestants in their IQ. And it's true that they did score less, but the problem with IQ testing that any psychologist or psychiatrist will tell you is that they're extremely culturally biased, right? Because it's not testing math, for example, can you add or subtract? A lot of it is testing general knowledge. And so the general knowledge you have is highly culturally specific, right? So for example, if you were a white child and they show you, okay, what do you eat dinner with? And they show you a fork and they show you a pair of sticks. You sit there and you think, well, duh, fork, right? That's what I eat with. And that's the correct answer. And they'll show the same thing to a Japanese child whose parents are from Japan, right? What do you eat with, a fork or sticks? And they're like, well, sticks, chopsticks, of course, right? No, you get it wrong, right? So it was stuff like that that made this highly questionable. But in any event, these tests are going to be used as a justification for restricting immigrants from certain places, as well as for treating minorities as second-class citizens. So if you needed to pause this video, you can do so now. Now, Europeans, when they came over, it was more or less assumed that they would eventually become Americans and assimilate. This was not necessarily true for non-whites that were coming into the country. World War I led to further growth in the Southwest of Mexican population. Labor was needed, so Mexicans who before had been subjected to literacy tests, for example, that were enacted in 1917 for entry into the country, they get exempted. Why? Because we need people to pick our crops, right? And so we have a lot of Mexicans coming into the country, but there wasn't really this expectation that they would assimilate and become just like everybody else. Segregation, both by law and by custom, was commonplace in states with significant Mexican populations. And it's important to distinguish between de jure segregation and de facto segregation. De jure segregation means segregation by law, right? There is a law that makes segregation happen. And then there's de facto segregation, which means in fact, and it's by custom. Regardless of what kind it was, de facto segregation was often just as ruthlessly and oppressively enforced as de jure was. And Mexicans were, and Mexican Americans were subjected to both, depending on where and when they lived. And so by the 1920s, Mexican children were usually educated in their own classrooms. Even if they went to the same school with other whites, they might be kind of forced into a classroom that was the Mexican classroom, for example. Oftentimes they would be subjected to lynchings, similar in the way that African Americans were, particularly if they stepped out of their quote place. This was less of an issue along the border per se, but the further you got, though it was in some places like Brownsville. But of course, the further you got from the border, the more of a problem this would become. Even more restrictive policies were put in place towards Asian Americans. By this time, the Chinese have already been cut off, but in California especially, we're seeing a lot of Japanese people immigrating to the United States. And so, for example, in 1906, San Francisco crammed all Asian American students into a single school, right? They're basically segregated into a single school for themselves. The United States, too, tried to crack down on this immigration. And in 1907, they entered into the Gentlemen's Agreement with Japan. In the Gentlemen's Agreement, this was not official. It was a handshake agreement meant to avoid embarrassment to Japan. But in it, Japan agreed to end migration to the United States, except for the wives and children of men already in the country. And they did, right? It virtually cut off immigration from Japan. And in 1913, California also barred Asian immigrants from owning or leasing land. And so this had a lot to do with economic tension and competition. And the fact that Asians and Asian Americans looked differently allowed them to be othered, right? If I'm already struggling, barely making it on my farm, and I see somebody who looks differently than me, speaks a different language than me, practices a different religion, and looks different, I can other them. It's their fault I'm not doing well, right? That's very, very common. And we see that happening on the West Coast and in California especially. So if you need to pause this video, you can do so now. So the progressives under with race don't have a very good record. The freedoms that the progressive era really didn't seem to apply to African Americans. Progressive intellectuals, scientists, labor reformers, suffragists, they all displayed a very remarkable indifference to the black condition in America. I guess the best person on race is Theodore Roosevelt. And even then, he's really only making symbolic moves, right? He did, for example, invite African-American leader Booker T. Washington to dine with him at the White House. He did appoint some black men to federal offices. That being said, he also ordered the dishonorable discharge of 156 black soldiers after they refused to name who had fired shots in an incident in Brownsville, Texas. One resident was killed, right? And so instead of, you know, investigating it, he just dishonorably discharged 156 black soldiers. Among these were six Congressional Medal of Honor winners, right? Wilson's administration was horrible on race. He was from the South. He himself was very racist. He is going to impose racial segregation in federal departments in Washington, D.C. When D.W. Griffin's Birth of a Nation is produced, Wilson is going to have its premiere at the White House in 1915. This is a film, and I'll show you a clip of it now, that was which glorifies the KKK as the defender of white civilization during Reconstruction. The KKK becomes the hero of this film, and the villains are the evil Reconstructionists in the South, and especially black troops who are portrayed as kind of little more than out of control, rampaging evil animals that are out to get these poor, beleaguered white people who are just trying to survive. This video and catch up on anything, you can do so now. Don't play it again. Okay. So things in the progressive era are tough for African Americans, but sometimes we forget, especially when we're talking about a disadvantaged group, that they do have agency. There is a reaction. And so African Americans did not necessarily take this lying down. They weren't like, okay, I'm oppressed, just lay there and take it, right? So probably one of the most important leaders during this time period is W.E.B. Du Bois, and he kind of led this revival of black protest. Du Bois tried to reconcile the contradiction between what he called the, quote, American freedom for whites and the continuing subjection of Negroes, unquote. By the way, please do not call your black friends Negroes. Don't write Negroes in papers unless it's a quote. I can't believe I have to tell you this, but judging by the papers that I read, I do. All right. So Du Bois wrote a work called The Souls of Black Folk in 1903. And in it, he took aim at Booker T. Washington. Booker T. Washington, in his Atlanta Compromise speech, had talked about accommodation, this argument that African Americans should accommodate themselves to segregation and disenfranchisement until they could prove their economic self-worth. In Souls of Black Folk, Du Bois takes direct aim at that and challenges Washington. And he argued that educated blacks like himself, what he called the talented 10th, must use their education and training to challenge inequality, that inequality was not acceptable. Now, in some ways, Du Bois is a product of his times, right? He is very much a typical progressive who believed that investigation, exposure, and education would lead to solutions for social problems. But he went a step further where he is going to be coupling this with political action. And so the political action side of this was the Niagara Movement. The Niagara Movement sought to reinvigorate that abolitionist tradition, right, in favor of claiming or reclaiming civil rights and social justice for African Americans. And in its Declaration of Principles, the Niagara Movement claim for ourselves every single right that belongs to a freeborn American, unquote. Radical, I know. Du Bois was also a co-founder of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. This was a group of mostly white reformers seeking to enforce the 14th and the 15th Amendment. And so it's important to note here that while large swaths of the country were incredibly racist and oppressive towards African Americans, be careful in your language not to lump all white people into that bunch, because here is a group of white people fighting against that. And it's easy and lazy to do, right, to say all white people were racist, right? And maybe to, at a subconscious level, they were, but not all white people were doing racist things, right? So be careful in your language. Anyways, the NAACP is still around today, still very important. They mostly challenge this in courts, right? They're kind of the legal arm of this. And they have early success with Bailey versus Alabama in 1911. In Bailey, the Supreme Court overturned a Southern peonage law that made it a crime for sharecroppers to break their labor contracts. And if you remember that approximately 75% of African Americans in the South were sharecroppers, you can see why this is a big deal. But that being said, progress for African Americans in the Progressive Era is going to be very, very slow. Not even military service ensured equal treatment. African Americans did serve in World War I. They served in segregated units. And many black leaders saw American participation in the war as an opportunity to make that promise of freedom real. Unfortunately, closing ranks did not bring significant gains to them, right? Military service did not translate into greater civil or political rights. One thing the war did lead to was something called the Great Migration. The Great Migration was when millions of African Americans left the Jim Crow South and moved north to work in the war industries. Because what happened was the war opened up thousands of industrial jobs to black laborers for the first time, either jobs that didn't exist before or jobs that would have been denied to them due to racism. And what this did was it inspired a large-scale migration from the South to the North. And this increased wartime production and the fact that you had no immigration from Europe due to the war and white men being pulled out to join the army meant that people were desperate for labor, right? So African Americans are getting these jobs, sometimes for the first time. So prior to World War I, 90% of African Americans in the United States lived in the South. And of them, 75% were sharecroppers. But between 1910 and 1920, 500,000 are going to migrate to the North. And there were many motives that sustained the Great Migration, right? There were higher wages than in the South, even if the work was unskilled. There would be education available for their children. This often meant an escape from lynching. Not always, but the threat was certainly less. And most importantly, it meant the right to vote. African Americans could and did vote in the North, and that more than anything is going to help explain why things begin to change for them. Now, that doesn't mean that African Americans did not face discrimination in the North too. While there were not de jure segregation laws in the North, there was de facto segregation, and there was discrimination in the jobs, and there was violence as well. De facto segregation was enforced violently, just like de jure segregation was in the South. That being said, those that went North did do substantially better than their counterparts that remained in the South, despite all these kind of problems. All of this, however, is kind of a drop in the bucket, right? Because overall, very little progress toward racial justice is made in the Progressive Era, despite these small steps. Now, if you need to pause this video, you can. So changing demographics, especially if there is economic competition, traditionally is a recipe for potential racial violence in the United States. And we see it during and immediately after World War I. There are riots, race riots, that will break out all across the country. One of the worst ones was in 1917 in a riot in East St. Louis, Illinois, where dozens of African Americans were killed. What had happened was an employer had hired black workers to come in and break a strike to weaken the union, right? And this is a very, I'm sorry, not to break a strike, but to they hired them to weaken the union. And this was a very common practice that employers would use, this divide and conquer. And so because blacks weren't allowed into the union, this was going to weaken it, and it led to this race riot. We also had a race riot breakout in Chicago in 1919 after a black teenager was drowned by whites in Lake Michigan after he crossed this imaginary line between the white beach and the black beach, right? This is an example of de facto segregation being enforced violently. So a big riot breaks out then. And this riot violence wasn't confined to the North either. The Tulsa riot in 1921 was the worst race riot in U.S. history, where over 300 black people were killed and over 10,000 left homeless after a mob and National Guardsmen burned all the all-black section of the city. There you can see a picture of it. And of course, lynchings are going to continue throughout this time period in the South, including of black GIs, right? Military service, being a veteran, didn't protect you from this extra legal means of control. Now we do see World War I kicking off a spirit of militancy among a minority of African Americans. And for those militant African Americans, they find home in Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey was a Jamaican immigrant, and he launched a separatist movement called the Universal Negro Improvement Association. And this called for African independence as well as black self-reliance. And so if you were to ask Garveyites, as they were called, what freedom meant, freedom for them meant national self-determination, just like the people in Europe were supposedly getting, this idea that they should be allowed to vote whether or not black people wanted to be part of the United States or have their own country, right? That idea. That being said, Garveyites were a very, very small minority, right? Most African American leaders, like Du Bois, viewed him as a demagogue. And eventually, Garvey is convicted of mail fraud and deported, and most African American leaders were happy to see him go. If you need to pause this, you may do so now. So now we're going to start talking about why 1919 was such a watershed year for the United States and the world. So 1919 is a time when we're going to see this kind of global desire for change coming to a head, as well as major events that kind of rock the world to its foundation. You had these militant hopes for social change that went far beyond the black community after the war, right? You see it, for example, in the USSR that was established after the revolution. Lenin had nationalized landholdings and banks and factories. This was an incredibly violent process, And Lenin's stated aim was he wanted to export this, right? So he's going to be trying to lead to this in other countries, which alarmed people, especially the middle class. You'll have general strikes all across the world, and in the United States, of workers demanding the fulfillment of wartime promises. In the United States, workers demanding promises of that industrial democracy, that idea of workers having a say in the management of the company and being paid a living wage. You have nationalist movements breaking out all over the world, people demanding self-determination. And this is all going to rage until 1919, until it kind of recedes, with the exception of the Soviet Union, right? And one of the reasons why things kind of calm down by the end of 1919 is because we have the flu pandemic in 1919, which is going to kill 20 million people in the world, which is twice that died in all of World War I. And over 700,000 Americans die in the flu pandemic. That's seven times that are killed in World War I. And here you can see a newspaper from the time, right? Like, they couldn't even have the Stanley Cup because most of the team was in the hospital with the flu. So this was a major deal. In 1919, the United States also witnessed unprecedented turmoil. 4 million American workers went on strike. The biggest one was the 1919 steel strike, which was centered in Chicago. It united around 365,000 mostly immigrant workers who went on strike, and they were demanding the fulfillment of that wartime rhetoric of economic democracy and freedom, and they were fighting for. They were striking for union recognition, for higher wages, and for the eight-hour day. Now, the steel magnates were not putting up with this. They are going to launch a concerted counterattack. And to do so, they appealed to anti-immigrant sentiment among the native-born workers. Once again, that divide and conquer, which was really effective. They also associated the strikers with the IWW, with the communism, like we saw going on in the Soviet Union, as well as claiming that this is disloyalty to America, right? That this is unpatriotic, using that propaganda from the war. And they were very effective at it. Remember, the steel magnates had the money, and they launched a full-out propaganda campaign to the point that most of the middle class opinion turned against the strikers. And once opinion turned against the strikers, it collapsed. And it's going to be a harbinger of what's about to happen to American labor. Where it kind of cracks under the pressure of both this fear of communism and this, you know, widespread propaganda and insistence on industrialism the way it was being maintained to the benefit of the owners. So if we need to pause this video, we can do so now. So this leads us to the Red Scare, which takes place from 1919 to 1920. And this was a short-lived but intense period of political intolerance, inspired by the post-war strike wave and the social tensions and fears generated by the Russian Revolution. Now, it was ignited after the post office intercepted bombs being mailed to politicians. And it was a period of intense instability. These bombs were being mailed when there was intense instability, there was racial violence, there was domestic terrorism, right? During the war, like, a lot of bombs were being set off places. So people were already on edge, but this took it to another level, right? Now, during the Red Scare and even during the Cold War, right, people who were educated were never actually concerned that the communists were going to invade, right? There was never this real fear that the communists were going to, you know, have tanks rolling down Main Street. During the Cold War, there was fears they might, you know, nuke us, but that's different from an invasion, right? The real thing that people feared that was possible was this idea of subversion, right? There was this belief that if America fell to communism, if America became communist, it would be through subversion. And so that's why there's this intense pressure of rooting out communists in the Red Scare here, and then later in the 50s in the McCarthy era. And so beginning in November 1919, lasting through January of 1920, the Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer, began dispatching federal agents to raid the offices of radical and labor organizations throughout the country. And this is the seeds of the future FBI, right? This is where the FBI gets born. And more than 5,000 people are going to be arrested. They're going to be held for months without charges. And if they were arrested and they happened to be an immigrant, the government would summarily deport them. Hundreds of immigrant radicals are going to be deported during this time period without due process, including the anarchist social activist Emma Goldman. And so Palmer eventually comes under heavy criticism from Congress and the press because he's abusing civil liberties left, right, and center, right? And this event does eventually plant the seeds for the importance of civil liberties that will take off in the 1920s, right? But the effects of the Red Scare are long-lasting and are still felt today because this was a major setback to labor, right? And labor organizations. Because essentially what ends up happening is that patriotism becomes linked with support for the political and economic status quo. In other words, if you complained about American capitalism, you were somehow unpatriotic and didn't love America. If you complained about the way things were, you were somehow unpatriotic and didn't love America. And that's persisted to the present day, right? When somebody today calls somebody a socialist or a communist, what they're really saying is you're unpatriotic. You don't love America. You're not one of us. And that comes from this, right? And the question to keep asking yourself is cui bono? Cui bono? Who benefits? Who benefits from that state of affairs, right? And certainly in the 1920s, it was the industrialist who benefited from that. And so this is going to discredit the American left for generations, right? The people that were calling for socialism or communism, whether or not you think those are good systems or not, those become subjects you're not even allowed to discuss anymore. And it really messes up the labor unions. The socialists are pretty much gone. The IWW has been destroyed. The existing labor unions, such as the AFL, are scrambling to try to define themselves in a way that don't violate this new definition of patriotism. So it's left in complete disarray and kind of left leaderless. And it also redefined the parameters of acceptable debate in the United States for generations, right? It was no longer permissible to discuss whether or not capitalism is a good thing or a bad thing, right? It was accepted that it was, period. And it may be, but the fact that you're not allowed to talk about it is what the problem is, right? That even just questioning that somehow made you dangerous or bad is one of the lasting and most harmful legacies of the Red Scare. And so I'm going to play for you a little video. I'm just kind of summing up the Red Scare.
The first act, in many ways the strangest and most terrifying of the entire decade, began in the spring of 1919. Before the troops had even finished coming home. On the evening of May 1st, a night clerk at the main branch of the U.S. Post Office on 33rd Street and 8th Avenue happened to notice 16 slender, identically wrapped packages, each addressed to a prominent politician or businessman, and each containing enough nitroglycerin to blow a man's head off. Confirming deeply rooted American fears that sinister foreign elements were at work in the land, Revelation helped set in motion the Red Scare, a wave of political reaction and xenophobia unlike anything seen in the country before or since. Directed at cities with large populations of immigrants, and especially New York. Within months, groups that had enjoyed triumphant success only a few years before, immigrant workers, progressive reformers, and union organizers, found themselves on the run.
And there are mass roundups. People are taken out, put on Ellis Island, and if they're aliens, they are slated for deportation. And, of course, the most famous deportee who is sent off in this period is Emma Goldman. And it's like a fever that grips people. there's another wave in early 1920, and then it breaks. It was like the fever had broken. And it's, I think, then that we really move into the 20s, and we've moved into a new climate. The communists are going to be driven underground. The labor movement is still there, but it's in serious disarray. You created a space where both globally, in terms of the competitors in Europe or basket cases, business in the United States and in New York in particular is looking at fabulous possibilities for normalcy, for profit making, for getting on with business.
Okay, if you need to pause this video, you can do so now. So the war's over, and the treaty that ends World War I is called the Treaty of Versailles. Why? Because it was negotiated at the Palace of Versailles in France. And so Wilson will personally travel to France to negotiate the treaty. And remember, the basis of the treaty was supposed to be the 14 points. That being said, the negotiations for this treaty were conducted in secret, which is already violating one of the principles of the 14 points and doesn't bode well for the treaty. Now, the Treaty of Versailles did accomplish some of Wilson's goals. For example, it did establish the League of Nations, that general association of nations that was meant to keep the peace. Ironically, the United States will never join the League of Nations, but the fact that it existed and is kind of the forerunner of today's United Nations is important. It did also apply the principle of self-determination to Eastern Europe, and we end up redrawing the map. So if you look at Europe in 1914 and Europe in 1923, they look completely different, and self-determination for Europeans, at least, was something that happened. That being said, this is a deeply flawed document. The Versailles Treaty was very, very harsh, and it all but is guaranteeing future conflict in Europe. Germany was declared morally responsible for the war, and they were forced to pay reparations somewhere between $33 and $56 billion. Meaning that the German economy is never going to recover. And it helped set the stage in Germany for extremists like the Nazi Party to rise. And Wilson's idea of self-determination, the idea that government must rest on the consent of the governed, and his belief in the, quote, equality of nations, did reverberate across the globe. You can understand why Wilson's language of self-determination raised hopes for many colonized people across the world. Unfortunately, it's raising false hopes, right? Because many took it far more seriously than even Wilson himself did. Because remember, Wilson himself was racist, and he did believe that colonial people needed a long tutelage before they would be ready for independence. But if you didn't know that about Wilson, and your average person probably didn't, if you just took the 14 points at its word, and believe that this is why America said it went to war, you could understand why Wilson initially was so very, very popular from everywhere, from China to Africa, and nationalists from everywhere, from Vietnam to Ireland to countries in Africa, descended on Paris, demanding independence, demanding self-determination. Well, the British and French, who were the victorious allies, right, and who are colonized most of Africa and Asia, for example, had absolutely no intention of applying the principle of self-determination to their own empires. In fact, during the war, the British had stoked Arab nationalism, manufactured it against the Ottomans, and promised to create a Jewish homeland for the Jews in Palestine, all to help aid their war effort against the Ottoman Empire. And what ends up happening is that the victors divided up the Ottoman territories into a series of new territories controlled, surprise, surprise, by the victorious allies under the League of Nations mandate system. And so it's here where we have the creation of the modern Middle East. You can see what the Middle East looked like before in 1914 and what it became in 1922. And all of this was designed to benefit these Europeans, where they basically now colonized the Middle East, in addition to having colonized already Africa and Asia. And so in many ways, this is setting the seeds of wars to come. By not applying the 14 points to, quote, not Europe, it really did create cynicism about the West and the Western's use of the language of freedom and democracy. Because apparently, freedom and democracy only applied to them. It didn't apply to these colonized people. Self-determination for me, but not for thee. And Wilson's apparent willingness to accede to the demands of imperial powers sparked protest movements all across the Middle East and Asia. And we begin to see a new anti-Western nationalism and anti-colonial nationalism emerge in non-European states. And some of them turn to communism, for example, like Ho Chi Minh in Vietnam. Others try to do a third way, like you'll see later on in Indonesia. And Lenin's reputation began to be better in the colonial world than the American reputation, because the Soviet Union seemed at least to support colonial peoples. In reality, you'd have to ask the Ukrainians how they felt about that. But in this case, this was the perception. And it also is going to lead to German resentment, right? Germans resented the terms of the treaty. It was very harsh. It was designed to keep them down. And it helped to fuel the rise of extremists like Adolf Hitler just a few years later. And finally, of course, self-determination. While it sounds great on paper, it's going to lead to a century of violence in the Balkans, in Eastern Europe, in Northern Ireland, and in the Middle East. This is the seeds of all this fighting that we see in the Middle East, that we saw in the former Czechoslovakia and the former Yugoslavia, right? Not Czechoslovakia, I'm sorry, Yugoslavia, and in the Balkans. So self-determination on paper sounded good, but in reality, it became a really kind of horrible thing playing out. So if you need to pause this video, you may. So Wilson negotiated this Treaty of Versailles, but under the American system, a treaty doesn't mean anything unless two-thirds of the Senate ratify it. And so Wilson had a big political fight on his hand, trying to get a hostile Senate to ratify this treaty. And Wilson himself viewed the new League of Nations as the war's finest legacy. But opponents to it viewed the League as a threat designed to deprive the United States of its freedom of action. They viewed it as forcing the United States into the affairs of other countries, forcing the United States to get involved in foreign wars, whether they wanted to or not. But Wilson refused to negotiate on these points. Wilson himself equated the treaty with, quote, the hand of God, which is kind of an unreasonable negotiating position to take, right? And many senators probably would have been willing to support it if Congress would have had the final say on whether or not the United States had to assist League members militarily. But Wilson refused to budge. Wilson refused to give even an inch on this. And he began touring the country, trying to get ratification, basically campaigning for ratification. And the stress on him was so great that in October of 1919, he actually has a stroke. Now, how damaged Wilson was by the stroke was kept secret, but he was incapacitated for the rest of his presidency. He disappears into the White House and you don't see him. And in fact, it was his wife, Edith, who basically headed the government. In the end, the Senate rejected the treaty. The United States never ratifies the Treaty of Versailles. The United States never joins the League of Nations. And after the war, the United States, at least initially, is going to retreat into isolationism. And this isolation was being fueled in large part by that disillusionment of World War I. Remember, this was supposed to be the war to end all wars, to make the world safe for democracy. And when you looked at what actually happened after the war, it was anything but. It seemed like the same old, right? And it leads to this widespread disillusionment, this widespread cynicism. This is also being led by the Republican Party, particularly a senator named Henry Cabot Lodge, that is arguing for the return to Fortress America, right? Against this idea of intervening in international affairs, we ought to stay at home and take care of ourselves and let the world burn as long as Fortress America stands. Now, in the long run, Wilson's interventionist model of behavior, of you know, intervening in countries on behalf of American interests and values, all the while promoting democracy, at least rhetorically, becomes the norm in the 20th and, I would argue, already the 21st century. But for a while, that wasn't guaranteed. And so, on its own terms, right, if this was a war to make the world safe for democracy, we failed in that. Because if you just look at the Middle East, look at what's going on in Asia, in Africa, it completely failed that test. And it also led to less freedom for industrial workers, right? Especially following the Red Scare. It also outright killed the progressives, right? World War I is going to kill the progressive movement. And we won't see these kind of ideas arise again for at least a generation. Why? Because remember, this was the progressive war. They are the ones that sold it. This will make the world safe for democracy. They're the ones that got people into it. And it turned out to be horrible. You know, 100,000 Americans, hundreds of thousands of Americans died or were injured. It looked like the same old after the end. People were horrified by this whole thing. And it does lead to the most conservative decade in American politics in the 1920s, beginning with the very corrupt Warren G. Harding in the 1920s and ending with it all crashing down on our heads in 1929 with Hoover and the Great Depression. So in this lecture, we discussed in what ways the progressive presidents promoted the expansion of American power overseas. We analyzed how the United States got involved in World War I. We identified how the United States mobilized resources and public opinion for the war effort. We discussed how the war affected race relations in the United States. And we analyzed why 1919 was such a watershed year for the United States and the world.